what providing more parking than you need, what that does is it distorts the choice that a resident or a tenant has in being able to use public transportation for the purposes of their journey. And what I mean by that is parking your car becomes so attractive and easy, then certainly that parking lot may fill up as a result. And what that would do is effectively increase the trip generation into and out of the site. Let's say if you were to have more levels of garage, the building would potentially be higher, more imposing to the street. And so parking can have an effect on planning and certainly the aesthetics of the building and transportation impacts as well. So I would submit to you that 43 parking stalls is not simply an adequate amount of parking for this project, but it also serves in the effect of bolstering the usage of public transportation, of walkability, of bike traffic. In addition to having parking stalls on the site, there would be bike storage and parking provided on the site as well. In addition to that, Mr. Broder touched on this, which I think is an excellent means in terms of encouraging lesser parking need within urban areas such as this, is that there would be an enterprise parking stall provided on the site. I know that may not appear significant, but studies actually show that that type of shared vehicle has the effect of reducing car ownership significantly. And you will speak more to that from a planning perspective, but can actually reduce the amount of cars utilized by tenants on the level of one shared car can reduce 15 owned and parked cars. So that is significant. It is certainly becoming something utilized more and recommended as part of planning standards. So I think to bring that into this development project certainly brings us in accordance with some more of the parking, prevailing parking thought these days. Now, I will say that parking has become something of a very popular topic with regard to transportation and planning discussions within the Institute of Transportation Engineers Journal, the Urban Land Institute, AIA journals. Parking within urban areas, transit-oriented development areas, certainly has become the source of many studies. So there's a lot of data that's starting to come in, counts, and sample information. The Institute of Transportation Engineers recently published a study that shows that residential projects within areas of high public transportation usage, such as this, can have parking ratios of less than 0.5 and actually function with high levels of occupancy for residential projects. So in terms of bringing this into the community in a way where it's less impactful, it certainly can have a very strong positive impact, in my opinion, with regard to parking. In addition to that, the city has a very well-planned system of implementing parking rules. You don't find that everywhere. What the city has and implements here with their parking authority is actually an excellent way to control and look at parking being provided throughout the city limits. There are a number of consolidated parking garage areas which are available for monthly passes, which allows a resident to essentially unbundle their parking from what they rent in terms of the unit. And what I mean by that is, in the past, when buildings such as this were built, everyone paid for parking that they may not have used as part of not owning the car. Because building those structured parking stalls can be quite expensive, and as a result, that's rolled into the rent, which as a result can make apartments and residential units less affordable, and certainly can make them less attractive in terms of visibility. So from an overall transportation planning perspective, the ability to possibly rent a parking stall within parking garages that are managed by the parking authority, or the opportunity in terms of utilizing the parking stalls within this building, certainly provide options to the user and the person that lives within the space. Now, in terms of the parking impacts of the site, we've utilized RSIS, and as I mentioned, that subsection within RSIS that very clearly states that there is great flexibility within the guidelines that are provided. We've looked at the Institute of Transportation Engineers and other guidelines, and in my opinion, the parking that's being provided on the site, again, as I mentioned, would be more than adequate to accommodate the demand because of where we're located, the proximity to the seminary, the proximity to the train station, and bus lines, as well as other amenities that are within walking distance. With regard to traffic, As I mentioned, I think the fact that we're providing parking that's adequate to accommodate the demand certainly has the opportunity to lessen traffic through providing the parking up to that guideline of 96 parking spaces. So from a balancing perspective, really looking at a development project from the perspective of architecture, planning, as well as transportation engineering, in my opinion, this project strikes an excellent balance and is in harmony with other projects in the area and certainly the public transportation infrastructure provided within the city of New York.
No further questions, Commissioner Vito?
What's the maximum number of occupants?
I believe we're up to 66 bedrooms. The Vigo occupancy, I don't know. Previously, the applicant had voluntarily offered to move the occupancy to two persons per bedroom. Previous version of the application that and just two items I'd like to add that I forgot about, but that brings that question actually to keep my remembrance of this, is that the applicant is going to waive the right to on-street parking as a result of this project. So certainly property owners within the area have the right to on-street parking. The applicant on the record is going to waive the right to have an on-street parking.
So if somebody asks a number, may I have that number, please?
132.
And one of the items that I'll add as part of working on many rental residential projects throughout the country at this time is that the need for parking, developers and applicants feel parking and structured parking to supply for projects such as this, the need for parking tends to be rather self-correcting. What I mean by that is that when residents apply for leases or look to live in a building such as this, Mr. Broder and his team, having operated a number of these types of projects, know very clearly how many parking stalls, how many parking stalls essentially they have allocated to certain residents within the building. And as a result of that, as the buildings fill up, they're able to have a very open dialogue with those that are applying for the opportunity to come in and live in these buildings, with the fact that they may be filling up or close to capacity and offer them other options, or simply they can find other residential projects throughout the city and neighboring areas if they wish to own a car and they wish to park in cars. So in terms of a lot of the prevailing thought that's being provided in terms of the industry and the experts in parking is that many times the developers and the applicants know best what serves their project. However, as I've stated, we've utilized all the guidelines here to look at the availability of parking here and if the demand will in fact supply will meet the demand that's provided here. My opinion, again, having to do with all of these different elements of it. I did. I looked at on-street parking, certainly drove through the area any number of times. We've been working on this project for the better part of the year, so I try to make it a point to drive by this area at certain times. On-street parking is certainly built during what I'll call the peak hours of residential parking, which tends to be later in the evening and earlier in the morning. People park their cars as well overnight. But the fact that the developer is coming in and waiving his right to on-street parking providing adequate parking on the site, in my opinion, lends no impact to what's happening on the street that, in fact, in some ways, has the opportunity to alleviate some of the experience on my street today.
Mr. Hughes, if you could then, please kind of start us with going through the snippet of work that you were asked to review, and then kind of go through your analysis, description of the property. I'd like you to, focus on those two areas, one of which is the development plan particularly, and of course, we need to provide your opinion.
Sure, just in terms of scope of work, the main objective was to be the appropriateness of the variance request from a planning perspective, as far as the land use law. I did inspect the site and the surrounding area, reviewed all the application materials, architectural plans, and et cetera. I also reviewed all the relevant sections of the Brunswick zoning ordinance, the master plan, and also the College Avenue redevelopment. Just with respect to the subject property itself, I just wanted to provide a little planning context here. So this is a new exhibit that we'll have to mark. This is an exhibit prepared by my office entitled 1792 Planning Context. And really, the goal here, and I think maybe I'll first go to the board members. But to illustrate some of the, number one, some of the transportation resources that are available in Washington, certainly the RE Student Center, which is very extensive bus system available there, a couple of blocks away from the particular property. Obviously, it's just across the street from the, or about a block away from the new theological seminary. Also quite close to College Avenue campus, walking distance to the Brunswick train station, and also very close within a block to the planned development, the new student housing and the public space, the outdoor living room, which is called at the corner of Hamilton Street and College Avenue. Just with respect to Mine Street itself, this is very much an area that's oriented to the university. If you look at the properties along Mine Street, between College Avenue and Eastern Avenue, as we did, only three owner-occupied properties along Mine Street in that entire area. Actually, 23 are either owned or affiliated with structures that are occupied by students, and then three commercial uses. So as you can see, it's very representative of this area in terms of its orientation towards university, seminary, and other institutions in the area. With respect to this particular location, I think that all supports the fact that this is a very ideal location for this proposed use. As the board is well aware, in this area, particularly the Sixth Ward, land is a very finite resource. This is a significant property of 20,000 square feet, and it's very much an important opportunity for the city to ensure that they can smartly redevelop or have quality projects. That's certainly one of the reasons why the city has decided to adopt a redevelopment plan and include this particular site. And that redevelopment plan, the College Avenue redevelopment plan, emphasizes the importance of efficiently using available space on and near the campus to develop new higher education uses and uses supportive of the higher education uses. And specifically for Area 2, in which this property sits, to encourage use of ancillary or in support of the college uses located in the neighborhood. So this use is permitted by the redevelopment plan, consistent with that village, with that vision for the area. And in accordance with the redevelopment plan, the applicant is proposing a privately owned and managed residential building with potentially a hybrid tenant base of seminary students and open market students that would include a few of the student market. Now, the master plan reexamination report in 2012 encourages this type of development in the Sixth Ward. On page 19 of that report, the planning board stated, many of the homes in the 5th and 6th Ward are relatively old, have not been well maintained, and are not designed to meet modern needs, particularly when used as college housing. As a result, there is a mismatch between the housing infrastructure and housing needs. Modern, purpose-built student housing needs to be developed, and newer rehabilitated can get to the parking area. I do just want to touch on briefly some of the design guidelines in the redevelopment plan. I think Mr. Schock is a very extensive description of the way in which this redesigned building relates to the treatment of the layer design guidelines. But clearly, the elements such as dormers, the mansard roof elements, bays, and some of the materials that are commonly found in the neighborhood directly respond and are consistent with the redevelopment plan emphasis on harmonious architecture with existing buildings and other substantial structures in the vicinity of the site. With respect to height, the redevelopment plan specifically encourages what we implement in this project, which is an upper story step back. And it's not nothing. Over 20 feet above the third story in terms of the story step back. And then, of course, in terms of the massing, the variation in materials, the texture and depth of the facade, all of those things create visual interest and break up the massing of the building. Again, very consistent with the guidelines in the plan. So I think there's no question here that this particular project not only complies with the use and bulk standards of the plan, but it's also very consistent with the design guidelines set forth in that document. And before I get to the parking variance, I do just want to touch on the issue of historic preservation, because it was something that was introduced at the outset of this meeting. I have not had an opportunity to review the letter that was embedded into the record. My understanding is it's some preliminary opinion from the State Historic Preservation Office with respect to the potential eligibility of this area. Although there's a lot of language in that letter based on what was read in the record about, you know, information that needs to be updated in terms of refining the boundaries. Here's what the board needs to know with respect to historic preservation and national registry. It actually provides no protection whatsoever for historic resources. For better or for worse, within the city's zone, the city controlled zone. If these, let's say a historic district was deemed eligible or was listed on the national register, those regulations have absolutely no teeth whatsoever in the city's zone. So I want to make that very clear for the record. Now back to the parking variance. The redevelopment plan, due to the RSIS standards for suburban residential development, requires 96 spaces per code. This is, as Mr. Levo stated, this is really a statewide uniform standard that applies to all residential developments across New Jersey, really without drawing meaningful distinctions between specific housing types. Certainly, specific housing is a different student as well. So, as planners, we often feel legally obligated to utilize RSI standards as a matter of state law. And I think in this case, at least back in the, I believe, the March hearing, Glenn Patterson, in his capacity as director of planning, did state that the city felt that it would really have no choice but to utilize RSI standards with respect to private housing development within the redevelopment area. So again, RSI does provide a great deal of flexibility. Section 5.21-4.14 does provide specific language and listing factors, including minimum number of parking spaces, or factors affecting minimum number of parking spaces, including household characteristics, availability of mass transit, urban versus suburban locations, and the availability of off-site parking resources. All of those factors come into play in this particular application. And in fact, the city did receive a letter from New Jersey DCA on May 27, 2014. Which clarified that the city has, quote, a great degree of flexibility to provide relief from RSI's parking standards based on the consideration of the site. So, we are requesting a parking variance. It will be presented and justified as a C2 variance, and that the purpose of the zoning of the variance can benefit the deviating from the ordinance requirements outweigh any detriment. And we will also, I will also address the negative criteria with respect to substantial detriment to a public good and demonstrate that the grant of the variance can be made without substantial impairment to the intent and purpose of the zoning plan of municipality. So just briefly, background on the parking issue. I think the board is very well aware of this issue as it relates to student housing. An area that was originally developed as one- and two-family housing, now mostly occupied by students. There's simply not enough parking in the driveway for some the master plan did address this issue in 2012 with the examination report. The planning board discussed the need to create, quote, realistic parking ratios for student housing in areas of, quote, walkability and maximum access. Page 59 of that particular report. And the recommendation was essentially that if student housing is anticipated in areas of walkability and mass transit access, a ratio of one on-site space per unit and or 0.5 spaces per bedroom should be considered. So while we are slightly below the 1-to-1 standard on a per unit basis, 52 units or 2 spaces proposed, the project actually well exceeds the per bedroom ratio that 33 spaces would be required to be 43 in the project. So it is clear to me that the proposed parking is consistent with the framework provided by the 2012 master plan examination. Secondly, transit alternatives in terms of the locational characteristics of this property. There are, as I stated at the outset, a number of potential destinations for residents within the project 10-minute walk. College Avenue campus, the student center, and Brunswick bus stop with access to the 10 bus line, theological seminary, the user who trained the bus stop at Houston Avenue, and in the near future, the community of the Well Center and the dictated public space, new housing at the corner of Houston College Avenue. Also, the parking authority now has identified the car share as a gateway parking deck, and of course, we run the train station as a short walk as well. We've also noted that there are potential bike lanes and other pedestrian improvements coming to College Avenue as part of the development and other planning efforts, which will only enhance the walkable nature or walkable quality and amenities in this particular area. So from a planning viewpoint, I think this area clearly has the assets and characteristics in place to support lower parking requirements than those required by our IS. Third, car share. Aside from the availability of transit here, I think it's important to factor car share into the equation. It's very significant, and the fact that it will be available on site, but also within the funds of parking authority gateway structure is significant. You know, both will be within range of use of the occupants of this building. And car share is really a textbook example of parking demand reduction strategies in practice. And so from a zoning standpoint, it's very common to actually reduce parking requirements to account for the anticipated reduction in demand for parking spaces reduced by the shared vehicles. So just by way of example, in Montclair, our firm prepared a redevelopment plan for a large mixed-use project that allowed for a reduction of six parking spaces for every shared car provider on the site. And those impacts are really more pronounced in a college campus environment. In fact, a study that was released in November 2013 was published in Transport Policy in the peer-reviewed academic journal entitled Car Sharing in a University Setting, revealed a reduction of 15.3 personal vehicles for every car sharing vehicle provided in a campus environment. So clearly the net result from the addition of car sharing is a net less parking demand on the property in the area. Also, what's highly unusual about this proposal is that Mr. Broder has actually taken the next step to pay annual membership fees for residents to participate in the car share program, which will only incentivize residents of this particular property to use that service and not rent a car. of a practical operational consideration. Again, this project will not be requesting any parking permits from the city. Applicant is relinquishing all rights to permits. Therefore, no quantifiable detrimental impact on neighborhood parking. If anything, this project will be taking more cars off the street. This project is actually building off-site parking. We look at most of the student housing uses in the 56th Ward simply either don't have parking or have insufficient parking to support student housing. A major benefit of this type of project is also that cruising for parking is eliminated. Tenants come directly on site to their spaces. There's no cruising the neighborhood around Line Street in the city looking for parking spaces. So if parking is full and a potential tenant has a car, they can either find somewhere else to rent, find another housing opportunity, or they could pay monthly parking at the wellness center desk, seek daily parking, utilize car share, or utilize transportation. So finally, just in reference to the benefits in accordance with the C2 justification, again, the main benefits here would be less traffic, and that means fewer cars going in and out of the building than if we had to go 96 spaces in accordance with the RSI standard. We ultimately get a better design building, and it really furthers a walkable, not auto-centric environment close to the theological seminary and the College Avenue campus. The grant of the variance would promote purpose A of the municipal land use law, because promoting transit alternatives and reducing traffic in a walkable campus environment certainly promotes the public health, safety, and general welfare of the community. Purpose E of the municipal land use law, in that the grant of the variance allows for an appropriate density of housing oriented to seminary and university students that will contribute to the well-being of the community by furthering the walkable nature of the campus area. Purpose G, and that provides sufficient space and appropriate location adjacent to the campus and a theological seminary for student-oriented and seminary housing. And finally, purpose H, and that we're reducing the cruising for parking phenomenon on the 6th Ward and encouraging less car usage in a walkable area by developing housing in the campus and near transit options. So the bottom line is that we have adequate parking for those who absolutely must need a car on a daily basis. But from a policy standpoint, overparking the project is really going counter to the city's vision for the College Avenue area. And in that regard, if you support decreasing cruising for traffic in the 6th Ward, if you support reducing demand for on-street parking, and encouraging more walking in this area, which is very suitable, then you should support projects such as this, which actually provide off-street parking, provide an adequate amount, and encourage transportation. Finally, with the negative criteria of public good, again, street parking is permit controlled. This project is not taking any parking permits to support the use. It will actually result in less movement in and out of the building, less traffic on Line Street, and if we have to comply with RSI standards. And the only possible outcome, I think, impact perspective would be increased demand for car sharing or daily long-term parking at the parking employee facilities, which would only be a benefit to the city. So we're basically discouraging the unnecessary overutilization of cars in locations that have plenty of transit alternatives. So in that sense, there's absolutely no substantial detriment to the public good. Finally, in reference to the zone plan, the redevelopment plan was adopted relatively recently in 2012 and provides requirements specific to this area too. However, as I noted, we do have evidence since 2012 that parking at less than 1:1 does work. And these projects occurred after the plan was adopted in 2012. So it is understandable that 1:1 would have been used as a rule of thumb at that time. And again, the availability of car share on site and within the parking authority's facility is an amenity that actually wasn't anticipated, it wasn't available at the time the redevelopment plan was created. And also, just like to remind the board that this project is below the 0.5 occasion per bedroom ratio that was recommended in 2012 master plan redevelopment plan. It is very consistent with the vision for a walkable pedestrian and atmosphere within the College Avenue area. For all those reasons, this while we are providing more than 0.5 space per bedroom, which is recommended by the development. So the reduction in units and the addition of car sharing, which is very innovative for this type of private development, certainly enhance the plan justification for the variance request. The benefits clearly outweigh the detriment, and we do think it can be granted in accordance with the solution.
I have no further questions.
Boat co-op in a waffle line. Okay, so the saga continues.